This is my second time recording this portion of this talk, and I'm beginning to think that, in fact, maybe the server room wasn't the best place to record. Especially not one with a fan. I'm this guy, and this talk is called Why OpenBSD? I'm this guy again, and I'm an intelligence analyst. I'm not a computer programmer, although I do know a few programming languages. I use programming languages to solve problems very often. Due to the nature of my job, I can only answer a few questions, although I do answer. I do welcome those questions which I can answer. I have a diverse set of skills. Of these skills, one is mathematics. I use mathematics on a day-to-day basis to solve various problems, which many would not be expected to be mathematical problems by those who only had an introductory look at mathematics. Computer literacy is another skill, which again, I use that on a daily basis, and that is relevant to this talk. Information literacy is also relevant to this talk, because even if I am information literate, if you have no documentation regarding your product, then I don't know how the hell I'm supposed to use a product, because there's no documentation there to find. Another skill is patience, which should be important for obvious reasons. I can also do necktie ironing. Isn't that nice? And I like to whinge and complain about incompetence, which may become apparent during this talk. Is a summary of my history with operating systems. I was introduced to MS-DOS / Windows in about 1986. I've used MS-DOS / Windows to the present, though I'm currently considering ditching Microsoft Windows. I used Mac OS X from 2002 to 2016. I used Slackware Linux from 1997 or so. And I used that for maybe a year. And then I dropped it, but I do occasionally go back to Slackware, just out of curiosity. I've used Fedora from 2005 to 2007. I just ended up getting sick of it. I used Ubuntu from 2005 to the present. I should say I use Ubuntu. I began using Ubuntu in 2005. I used Arch Linux from 2003 to 2004. I've used OpenBSD from 2000 to the present, and I've used FreeBSD from 2002 to the present. MS-DOS was really it as far as the consumer market went in 1986, although enterprise equipment did differ. Because I used MS-DOS a lot during this time, MS-DOS always felt like home to me. It still somewhat does. I consider this to be a positive. I also consider it to be a positive the ease of use via simplicity of MS-DOS. Due to the disk space requirements, where in 1986, really through 1990, hard disks were fairly small compared to what we have now, you couldn't fit terribly complex things on there. So what you had were simple commands, easily learned. When I went to Microsoft Windows, the graphical user interface really was a breath of fresh air. And I do consider that to be a positive. Microsoft Windows remains the dominant operating system. I consider this to be a positive because plenty of support is available for this operating system as a result of its dominance. I like pre-2006 Windows because I think it feels welcoming, and it's easily used. I don't know why I wrote that Microsoft Windows has decent documentation here. It doesn't. Its documentation is terrible. And certain software is only available on Windows. Only officially available on Windows. I hope this is a neutral, because this is technically a reason to use Microsoft Windows, although it's not a very good reason. I went to Mac OS X, largely because I wanted to try a new operating system. Mac OS X was very user-friendly. It was intuitive. This changed, and I don't remember when it changed. I just know that I like complaining about it. When this change happened, the UI, which was then fairly speedy, became slow. It was digested and turned into crap. Fedora Linux is supposed to be user-friendly, and I've seen this to some extent, but really I should have marked this as being neutral. Not sure why I marked it as positive. Fedora Linux is part of the origin of Security Enhanced Linux, because Red Hat, which is affiliated with Fedora Linux, took part in the creation of Security Enhanced Linux. However, Fedora Linux is buggy, and Fedora Linux's documentation is fairly bad. Ubuntu Linux, one of the big advantages to this is it requires minimal configuration. It's really just get it out of the box, it's ready. Along with this, Ubuntu is allegedly user-friendly. And I see some extent to that, right? I see that to some extent. However, really, it's only user-friendly if you're doing common things. If you want to do something which not that many people do, then you might be hard-pressed to find a way to do that. However, if you're doing it, then chances are it's not... If you're doing it, then chances are someone else has done it. So you're not totally out of luck. And speaking of that, Ubuntu has a very helpful community. However, Ubuntu is slow, with programs like Network Manager, which is hideously bloated. And there exists a negative stereotype surrounding Ubuntu, saying that essentially pretentious people use it. Or I guess pretentious isn't the right word. But people want to say they understand Linux without needing to do any of the dirty work, I guess you could say. Arch Linux can be extremely fast, and Arch Linux is very configurable. However, Arch Linux is unstable, with the problems of, oh dang, I broke it, and, oh dang, the update broke it. OpenBSD, the main two things here for me are the excellent security and the phenomenal documentation, which are largely the result of having an unusually committed team. The OpenBSD team is very determined to create the best Unix-based operating system. Create the best Unix operating system out there, from what I've seen. Yeah, the mascot looks cool. However, OpenBSD is a bit slow due to some security mitigations. OpenBSD cannot mount SIFS drives, and the overall compatibility is fairly lousy. But this is done for the sake of security. And the cat just walked in. FreeBSD has good documentation, although it's not as good as OpenBSD's. There's just a slight difference. However, FreeBSD arguably makes up for this by having pretty decent compatibility, even supporting Wine. FreeBSD also has a decent team. However, FreeBSD's security is relatively poor. OpenBSD versus Microsoft Windows. Whereas OpenBSD is extremely stable, Microsoft Windows was fairly stable. OpenBSD currently works perfectly for months, in my experience, whereas Windows once worked perfectly for weeks. Also, on OpenBSD, processes can be terminated instantly via the kill-niner command, whereas on Windows, process termination is only actually requested. A signal is sent to the process, and it's left to the process to commit suicide, essentially. On to security. Sorry about that. Maybe I should put on the wind blocking stuff. On to security. OpenBSD is security focused, and as such, OpenBSD has few exploits and extensive privilege control. Whereas Microsoft Windows, which is not security focused, once had user account control, which essentially policed users and said, "You're not supposed to be doing this, or you're sure you want to do this," was deemed to be too inconvenient and was kind of a, nerfed. It was nerfed. Microsoft Windows also has a lot of exploits, such as WannaCry, which was a big fiasco, as you might know, as well as crappy privilege control. This also begins the problem of closed versus open source, where OpenBSD, due to being open source, I can know exactly what it's doing at any time, which means I can know exactly what security vulnerabilities OpenBSD has if I really want to check that out. Microsoft Windows is not the case. If I want to know what vulnerabilities Microsoft Windows has, then I need to go in and reverse engineer it. And that takes a hell of a lot more time than just auditing the source code. Ease of use. Although OpenBSD is unintuitive to new users, OpenBSD does provide excellent documentation and can be easily learned with an open mind. OpenBSD also does not pretend to be intuitive, whereas Windows does pretend to be intuitive. What I mean by this is, Windows does not provide documentation on everything, but Microsoft does not provide documentation on every feature of Windows, because Microsoft assumes that for all things in Windows, the thing in Windows is sufficiently intuitive that no manual is needed. However, this assumption is wrong. As I can tell you, I don't know exactly how the new Start menu works. I don't understand Windows 10. And there's no manual for it. So I have no real way of understanding it. And, you know, when stuff is documented, it's really just the bare minimum. However, an exception is some enterprise stuff. On to performance. On OpenBSD, the processor speed is directly controllable. Whereas, on versions after Vista, the processor speed is controllable. However, to control the processor speed, the user has to go into a fairly well-hidden settings menu. And even then, once he's found that, you can only select between a few settings. So, if you want truly variable speed control, you have to install something like SpeedFan. Although SpeedFan doesn't do speed control from what I remember, which maybe that's changed. Also, in OpenBSD, all background tasks are user controllable, either by modifying runtime configuration files or just by modifying the source code. Whereas on Windows, let's assume that something can be modified. If you want to modify it, no first-party documentation exists, as it probably doesn't, then you have to search some bad online guides for information regarding this setting. Then you have to find this crappy configuration file which contains the setting. Then you go into this crappy configuration file that you find the setting and you change it. And you might end up just breaking your machine, which is, it's always an inconvenience. Might make you want to cry at times. Automation. OpenBSD actively promotes automation by providing cron jobs to the user and almost demanding an ability to use shell scripting. Microsoft Windows, on the other hand, although Microsoft Windows does provide some automation stuff, the documentation for this stuff is god-awful. And certain things are essentially undoable with this system. As such, AutoHotkey and similar tools are necessary if you really want to automate your Windows system. However, even then, it can't perform all actions. OpenBSD has a standard application installation interface via package add, whereas Windows 7 has no inbuilt repository, and Windows 8 has the Windows Store, which is poo-poo. Should mention Windows 10 does as well, I believe. All these systems, you can download external binaries. I don't recommend doing that. That's possible. On all these systems, you can also use make and similar commands too. Create binaries from source files. On to customization. In OpenBSD, the modification of source code is encouraged because the best things in life are free. And the BSD license makes distribution of modified files extremely easy. Basically says, as long as you don't impersonate us for financial gain or remove our copyright notices, you're free to do whatever you want. On the other hand, Windows code modification is very strongly discouraged, because the source code is only available to Microsoft and company. Also on customization, OpenBSD uses the X Window system for window management in the graphical interface, whereas Microsoft Windows uses Direct Window Manager, I believe it's called, and Windows Explorer, which is now just a disgusting bloated mess. Transparency. In OpenBSD, understanding the system is encouraged through some of the best documentation I've ever seen, the frequently asked questions page, and the ability to contact the developers with questions. Whereas in Windows, understanding the system is often discouraged, as hardly any source code is given out, and what little code is given out is often obfuscated. Whereas in the case of OpenBSD, all the source code which I've read has been very consistent and clean. And I like that. OpenBSD versus Mac OS X. Stability. OpenBSD is a BSD, and it runs for months. Mac OS X, or not so OpenBSD, is a BSD, and it runs for weeks. But kernel panics are relatively frequent, and there's quite a lot of hanging in system processes, from what I remember. Finder was particularly bad, as was the dock. I remember the dock acted kind of shitty. If you had too many, if your hard disk was too fragmented, the dock would act really shitty. Security. On OpenBSD, the secure shell daemon is enabled by default. The secure shell daemon does not permit a root login. This is great for servers and great for remote work, although this is fairly terrible for terminals, because terminals don't need this. On Mac OS X, however, Secure shell is disabled by default. This is great for terminals and personal computers, but it's not good for servers, and it's not good for remote work. So, if you use Mac OS X, then you might want to fix that. Application installation, in OpenBSD, an inbuilt repository is held in package add. Whereas in Mac OS X, this is done via the App Store, and other sources are discouraged. Because Apple doesn't trust that the users of Mac OS X are capable of making good decisions. Also, on OpenBSD, programs can be compiled from the source, and the binaries can just be downloaded and executed on the local machine. Ease of use. Although OpenBSD is not intuitive for new users, OpenBSD can be learned fairly quickly. Due to the excellent documentation and the lack of pretending to be intuitive, Mac OS X is not the same way. I don't find that Mac OS X is very intuitive anymore, and the lack of decent documentation does not help. Actually, the lack of documentation does not help. At this point, Mac OS X just pretends to be intuitive, maybe for the sake of doing it. Performance. OpenBSD has multiple possible user interfaces. Of these user interfaces, many are very basic, many are very fast, and some are just god-awful. Namely, XFCE is just god-awful. On Mac OS X, Mac OS X has one accepted user interface, and that's the default Apple user interface, which I really hate it at this point. Yeah, it might look kind of nice if you're attracted by everything shiny, but it's slow as ass. And that's not nice if you're doing any kind of number crunching or something. Extreme tweaking is also encouraged on OpenBSD, whereas this tweaking is discouraged on Mac OS X. Again, because Apple does not trust its users. OpenBSD's install is also capable of fitting onto a hard disk less than 2 gigabytes, whereas Mac OS X needs at least a 15 gigabyte hard drive. Automation on OpenBSD is provided by cron and shell scripting. Manuals for both of these topics are available within the system, and all users are encouraged to automate stuff. On Mac OS X, however, Automator is supposed to be the main automation tool. But Automator is very untraditional, and because I like tradition, I haven't used it. And I haven't used Mac OS X in 4 years. Although shell scripting and cron jobs are also available. Transparency. OpenBSD's transparency is great. It is very much a great example of transparency in computer programs, because not only is understanding the system encouraged, but the source code itself is very clean and public. That helps too. Whereas Mac OS X is closed source, aside from a few things, and those things which are released to the public, in my experience, they've generally been obfuscated, which isn't nice. OpenBSD versus Ubuntu Linux. I should say Ubuntu Linux. Stability. OpenBSD is really a case of set it and forget it. You punch your settings in, and no updates are going to break those. Your configuration files do exactly what you told them to do when they were installed. And the system continues to work for months without any errors. Ubuntu Linux, however, is in my experience, Ubuntu Linux has been relatively unpredictable. Some of the servers which I have which run Ubuntu Linux are reliable, however other servers are very unreliable. As an example, one of my servers here, that server was having a boot problem where whenever you turn that server on, it would not boot into Ubuntu Linux. It would not boot into Ubuntu Linux. Instead, it would sit at the boot screen for, I think it was an hour. So I eventually thought, you know, to hell with this, and I restarted it. Nothing happened. I restarted it again, and I finally booted into Ubuntu Linux. So, I still don't know what the hell that problem was. I did something, ended up fixing that, after I got sick of...
Well, I can't restart this thing or nothing.
So, that's not good. Yeah, certain tweaks like that are often necessary with Linux. However, Ubuntu Linux can work for months, but it's not guaranteed, and don't forget that. Security. OpenBSD is a very security-focused operating system. OpenBSD, all things which are created by the OpenBSD team, in total, have fewer than 300 known exploits, approximately 300 known exploits, as I'm narrating this. And, you know, it's important to consider that OpenBSD has plenty of tech-savvy users who would have found exploits. However, OpenBSD does not have support for Wayland, which is known to be more secure than the X-Window system. Ubuntu Linux, on the other hand, utilizes the Linux kernel, which was made carelessly and features at least 100,000 exploits. That's just the exploits we know of. But it does support Wayland, which is nice. Ease of use. OpenBSD provides excellent documentation. And the Frequently Asked Questions page describes just about everything else you would need to know and couldn't figure out for yourself. Whereas Ubuntu Linux, documentation is...
Yeah.
But there does exist a Stack Exchange website such that this website is dedicated to Ubuntu Linux. That is the only distribution which is discussed on this Stack Exchange site. Performance. OpenBSD, or I should say, of these, neither is a minimal installation. However, in the case of OpenBSD, the non-essential stuff is not easily enabled. Whereas on Ubuntu Linux, some of the non-essential stuff is initially enabled. On both operating systems, this non-essential stuff can be easily removed. Automation is provided on both systems via cron and shell scripting. OpenBSD does package management via package add, which, sure, it's user-friendly, but it's a bit slow. OpenBSD also permits the building of a user's own binaries from source, as well as the downloading of pre-built binaries. Ubuntu Linux has an inbuilt package repo by Debian Aptitude. And this is user-friendly and faster than package add. Users are also allowed to make their own binaries and download external binaries again. Both are about the same for transparency. The recorder into which I am speaking is currently sitting in a bowl of Chex Mix. I use Arch, by the way. Stability. OpenBSD, as we've already established, set it and forget it runs for months. Arch Linux. Setting changes are often necessary because Arch Linux is notoriously unstable. One update could break what the next update mandated you had. One update could break what the previous update mandated you had. Arch Linux could potentially run for months. However, this is unlikely because we have the scenario of a new exploit was published, as well as a patch. Aw, oh, dang, the pants broke it. Ease of use. In the case of OpenBSD, documentation is excellent. In the case of Arch Linux, documentation is good. OpenBSD has very consistent interfaces across default utilities. Arch Linux does not have consistent interfaces across all default utilities. Performance. OpenBSD is a bit slower by default, due to having some security mitigations and miscellaneous utilities. Whereas Arch Linux can be ludicrously fast if you're willing to tweak it and get it exactly where you want it. This is partially due to Arch Linux's bare bones nature. Of these choices, both are highly tweakable, which is nice. Security. OpenBSD is security focused. Approximately 300 known exploits exist. And OpenBSD does not support Wayland. We've already established this. Arch Linux uses the Linux kernel and supports Wayland. Package management. In OpenBSD, package management is provided by PackageAmp. In Arch Linux, package management is provided by Pacman. Both operating systems support compiling from source and installing external binaries. Transparency. Both systems encourage understanding the system. However, the extent to which OpenBSD's source code is clean is greater than the extent to which Arch Linux's source code is clean. OpenBSD versus Fedora Linux. Stability. As we've already established, OpenBSD is very stable. However, Fedora Linux is somewhat unpredictable, in that Fedora Linux can run for minutes to months. And when I was using Fedora Linux, I really didn't see any sort of correlation between what I was doing and the survival of the system. Security. We've already established OpenBSD is very secure. Fedora Linux utilizes the Linux kernel and supports Wayland. Ease of use. OpenBSD's documentation is excellent, whereas Fedora Linux's documentation is fairly mediocre. On OpenBSD, the GUI is not enabled by default, although Fedora Linux's is. However, the default GUI of Fedora Linux is a bit slow. It reminds me of a less intuitive version of Windows 95 or Windows 98's user interface. Whereas OpenBSD's default user interface is very fast, but it looks a bit ugly. That's about the worst you could say about it. Performance. OpenBSD is somewhat slow due to having security mitigations, although many sources of this slowness can be disabled. OpenBSD is not a minimal installation, although stuff can be easily disabled. Fedora Linux to me always felt slow, and it is slow for what Fedora is. Fedora is not a minimal installation, although stuff can, as in the case of OpenBSD, be easily disabled. Automation. Yeah, they're about the same. Transparency. In both cases, the source code is public. However, the extent to which OpenBSD encourages understanding the system is greater than the extent to which Fedora Linux encourages understanding the system. From what I remember, the source code of Fedora Linux is a bit messy compared to OpenBSD's. OpenBSD versus FreeBSD. OpenBSD runs for months. FreeBSD runs for months. OpenBSD updates rarely break things. FreeBSD updates rarely break things. FreeBSD says, are you copying me? OpenBSD says, are you copying me? Security. OpenBSD. One of the philosophies there is security is of the utmost importance. Therefore, performance is, in a lot of cases, traded for security. FreeBSD is the opposite case. Security is often traded for speed. However, both are still pretty good in terms of security. Ease of use. OpenBSD has excellent documentation. FreeBSD has just very slightly worse documentation. On OpenBSD, utilities are very consistent with each other. On FreeBSD, utilities are just very slightly less consistent with each other. Both are great. Performance. OpenBSD is slower than FreeBSD. In the case of OpenBSD, speed is sacrificed for security, whereas FreeBSD sacrifices security for speed. OpenBSD is better for paranoid nutcases, and FreeBSD is better when speed is of the utmost importance. Automation is the same on both. Transparency. Both encourage understanding the system. Both have clean source code. Both say, no really, stop copying me. OpenBSD's mascot, Puffy, is a porcupine fish who has defensive spikes. FreeBSD's mascot, Beastie, is a little demon guy who has a trident, which can be used for spaghetti. This video has summarized my reasons for using OpenBSD as opposed to other operating systems. If you have any complaints about the video, then please write these complaints in the comments. I read those, and I would very much appreciate criticism.